my question for you, I guess, is there something even more sinister going on? You mentioned Bill Gates. Let's talk about Bill Gates. I mean, does Bill Gates simply fall on the side of, hey, he thinks that we need more government and people need to be protected by government and this is an important role? Or is he really doing this for some ulterior motive that benefits him personally or some type of global cause that we're not focusing on?
Well, I guess it's a matter of how somebody, one, connects the dots. I mean, he said in this interview with Chris Anderson, he talked about how they don't want too many people recovered. They want to test a lot of people. They want to develop antivirals and vaccines. And they want.
Okay, hold on. I have to interrupt you and just have you clarify, because it's a pretty startling statement. What do you mean they don't want too many people recovered?
He said that. I can quote you from the article. He said that, just find the place. He said, we don't want to have a lot of recovered people. This is a direct quote from his interview. To be clear, we're trying through the shutdown of in the United States to not get to 1% of the population infected. We're well below that today. This is March 24th. But with exponentiation, you could get past that 3 million, which I believe is 3 million people, or approximately the 1% of the U.S. population being infected with COVID-19. Then he said, continues, I believe we'll be able to avoid that 1% infected, more than 1% infected, with having this economic pain, i.e. the shutdowns.
Mm-hmm. So the only thing I could extrapolate from that, giving him the benefit of the doubt, as far as not wanting too many people to have recovered, meaning I don't want that many people to have been infected, because the more infections, the more death.
But he also said earlier in the interview, he admitted it's very infectious, but not a high fatality rate. And he literally talked about trying to ways of making money from this. The host said, well, could we use antibodies from people who have recovered to try to treat other people who have not yet been exposed and therefore don't have antibodies? And he said, well, you know, it really doesn't make much money. It's a lot of work it's a lot of steps to get to those antibodies and be able to pack them and sell them, as opposed to just some product they can give to people.
Meaning the vaccine.
Yeah, or antivirals. That's pretty, yeah.
Well,
that sound like somebody who's doing it for purely? And then there are all his ties to vaccine companies, and there was an amazing, I don't know if you want to go to that yet, or an amazing investigation that came out on March 20th about the, in The Nation, talking about Bill Gates and his foundation and his ties to pharma companies and all the tax deductions he gets for giving to these very lucrative, well-financed.
Well, I do want to get into that. I mean, one question I could raise is that, okay, if the goal is to get to vaccines, I get how Big Pharma benefits from a vaccine. But by the same token, doesn't Big Pharma benefit from a lot of people being sick, who then take antivirals or whatever types of medications? And so we're very much reducing the number of people that are getting sick, which is not great for Big Pharma. So how do you balance those two things out?
Well, it seems a battle against our body's own immune system, which is the natural ability to produce antibodies and make us well, and to be able to, the next time we're challenged or we're faced with that same virus, then we're fine, we're immune. Whereas Bill Gates' thesis seems to be keep a very low population exposure to the virus, so a very low rate of people that will actually become immune. And then he's very busy, you know, working with companies that are going to produce, with the WHO, the World Health Organization also. We're going to then pump up the production of antivirals and vaccines, and people need to prove that they have, you know, one of these or maybe antibodies to be able to get anywhere. And that the problem with then is it's going to be a continuing cycle of having to test and then do antivirals and vaccines each time this virus rolls through the population. So that's very lucrative for the companies, as opposed to letting more people be exposed and then the next time they won't have to be using all these expensive modalities for treatment, testing and treatment. Mm-hmm. And it's blowing away the principles. Well, I was a medical journalist for 22 years, and there was a whole program that was widely touted and widely followed called Choosing Wisely, saying, let's get the best use of our resources for, and whatever part of the political spectrum you're on, I think that's a reasonable, most people can agree to that. Let's not do unnecessary testing and unnecessary treatment, because it's wasteful. and it scares people. If you're getting tested for something and you find out you've got a false positive, for example, you found out you've got breast cancer, or in fact you don't, that's a tremendous cost to the individual and to society. And we can also talk about the testing for viruses. There's plenty, the PCR testing for COVID-19 apparently is a lot of false positives, even though officials deny that, but at least here they deny that.
How do you explain everyone buying into this total lockdown? You know, this is not just, this is Trump for the most part buying into it. This is the various U.S. state governors. This is all the provinces of Canada. This is every country we can think of except for Sweden. Are all of them just wrong?
Well, I would say yes, and I would say there's.
But how did we get in the circumstance where everybody could be so wrong? I mean, Sweden's the only one we can think of. And a handful of U.S. states like Wyoming or South Dakota.
Right, they're not being locked down.
No, there's like five states that have not issued lockdown orders in the U.S. However, cities within those states have ordered them. So I'm not sure there's any city of any significant size in the U.S. that doesn't have a shutdown order right now.
Well, because there was somebody called, there are very few public health officials or anybody at any sort of level who's speaking out against this. There are some scientists like Dr. John Ioannidis, who's famously now really speaking out and saying this is totally wrong-headed, and more epidemiologists, they are speaking out. There was an official called Dr. Joel Kettner, who called into our national broadcaster, the Canadian Broadcasting Companies Corporation's national call-in show called Cross Country Checkup. I think it was March 25th. He called in, he said, he wasn't allowed to be a guest, but he called in saying, he was the chief medical officer of health of Manitoba, one of our provinces. And he said, and we have yearly epidemics. It's called the influenza. And I've never seen anything like this. And his thesis about what's going on, he's not quite sure what's going on. He says, when the World Health Organization, with the head of the World Health Organization, Tedros, says, this is a grave concern, we've got to do everything, and we've got to, it's an epidemic, and he's cajoling countries like India for not doing enough. He says that sends a very strong signal. Dr. Kettner says it sends an extremely strong signal to public health, to governments, that they had better toe the line and they better listen, they'd better do what they're told. Yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And also, there was also this thing called Event 201, whether this is a good time to mention it, but it was a simulation of a novel coronavirus pandemic that was conducted in October 2019 in New York. And it was funded by the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, the World Economic Forum, and by part of the Johns Hopkins School of Health, the Bloomberg School of Health, I believe, or medicine. And it talked about, really not a good idea to let people walk free, and there should be a full court press. And with officials at all levels of government calling flooding the zone and using trusted local officials to give those messages about what should be done and how. And he also talked about the head of Edelman Public Relations Global was there at this round table, which is the center of Event 201. And he said, that's a great idea to flood the zone so no counter narrative can really gain traction. And he said, we should train those officials in advance. And also every week, there's the coordinated by Bloomberg Foundation, Bloomberg Philanthropy. There's been weekly education sessions for mayors around the world. There was a tweet about it by Bonnie Crombie, who's the mayor of a city right near Toronto called Mississauga. It was a tweet a few days ago saying, thanks to this for these weekly sessions. This is the fifth one. And we had Bill Gates on this week as the guest. Wasn't that great? So that speaks to some degree of, and these sessions are about crisis control and emergency. Yeah, so it's interesting.
Mm-hmm. Well, you mentioned that people are finally starting to speak out about it, but you have to be careful what you say about it, because you can be ostracized, or political correctness is deems that you have to pretty much go along with the shutdowns. And I do think that there's a lot of voices out there that probably would like to speak that are afraid to speak. And in fact, there's this theory, people would call it a conspiracy theory, and perhaps it is, but there are many scientists that have said that 5G can be very unhealthy for you, and now people are relating that to the virus. And if, but if you dare do that, I don't know if you've heard this, I just learned this today, that YouTube has taken down any video that mentions this conspiracy. In fact, I just mentioned it, so goodbye to our video. We're probably going to have to edit this out. As absurd as that sounds, absolutely insane that you can't even talk about it, YouTube is going to take you down. Now, I'm not saying that's what's going on, but man, now is the time for free thinking and all. And there's no bad ideas right now as to what the heck is going on here. You know, relating this to what you're just talking about and with Bill Gates and so on. I mean, no one was talking about pandemics before this except for Bill Gates. So I go back and forth on Bill Gates. On the one hand, I'll say, well, hey, he's the one, at least he was the one talking about this and trying to warn people about this. Our politicians weren't saying anything about it and preparing us for it. So is it that Bill Gates, we should have been listening more to Bill Gates? Or is it that, well, nobody was talking about it because it isn't a real problem, and instead it's just being turned into a big problem by Bill Gates and the like for whatever purpose they may have for it? So pick up there, please.
Wondering where does the narrative come from and who's benefiting or who's, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, which is it? Bill Gates is either the guy that everybody should have been paying more attention to, or he's the bad guy in all this who has taken something that should have been treated like the flu and instead has turned into this, what it's turned into, which is this worldwide shutdown that's causing huge economic damage. So which is it?
Well, I think you're a critical thinker, as am I. I think you have to take everything you see and read and think for yourself and deduce what's the most logical conclusion. Don't start from the point where Bill Gates is God or Bill Gates is the Antichrist, but really try to connect the dots. So, I mean, for example, the fact that he endorsed lockdowns, and he has tremendous influence on the World Health Organization as well. He gives billions to the organization. He's treated like, according to an article in Politico in 2017, he is treated like a head of state. And not just by the WHO, but by other powerful organizations. He's tremendously powerful, and he is very strategic in where he puts his money through the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, and for which he also gets, they get tremendous tax reductions or tax. So I think just, you know, he doesn't know a vaccine he doesn't like. he gave $10 billion to the World Health Organization in 2010, sort of as a kickoff for the decade of the vaccine. He was kicked out of India, I believe, for kind of hyper-promoting the medicalization of and experimenting on the children there with vaccines. I mean, there was a really good article by Robert F. Kennedy Jr. That was published, and he talks about some of the problems with Gates. It was published on Zero Hedge on April 12th, and it was Robert F. Kennedy Jr. He's with the Children's Health Defense, and he talked about, for example, that he wrote that, quote, global public health advocates, and these are global public health advocates, they're not people who have taken one position or the other about vaccines, et cetera, but they, around the world, these global public health advocates accuse Gates of steering WHO's agenda away from the projects that are proven to curb infectious diseases, like clean water and hygiene and nutrition and economic development, instead towards vaccination.
Well, let's talk about one of the biggest things that Gates always seems to be getting hit on, which is called the digital ID?
Right.
So talk about what that is and what Gates has said about that being something that he supports.
Well, I guess that just this one part from the interview, when he says eventually there will be this digital immunity proof that will help facilitate the global reopening. And there have been articles, I know Germany, I think it was in, there was an article in The Guardian about 100,000 people or something are getting serologically tested for antibodies in preparation for this, you know, you have to prove whether you're immune or not or been vaccinated. And I think the UK is pondering it. I think Trump did mention it. And I did see a paper that somebody sent to me a few days ago about getting literally microchipping people. Some sort of thing you implant in people that you can use, scan with infrared or something to see their vaccination record. So that's moving along very quickly. And because the gateway has been open to this with all the full court press, with the likes of Gates and the WHO and many pharma companies and leaders of countries, certainly in Canada and maybe, and also Trump in the States saying, we need the vaccine. That's the only way out of this. You know, we're moving towards that goal of in X number of months having vaccines. So we're being sort of herded towards this. The only way out is a vaccine. And we're herded towards this digital immunity proof. I mean, is that way that we want to live? Do we want our children to live that way? That you have to have the microchip to whether you've been vaccinated?
I mean,
and people around the world, they're moving towards doing this.
Yeah, for believers in individual freedom, you know, people, those, that side is going to rebel against that. But for those that tend to believe that a government can be trusted and is there and generally does good for the people, they are okay with the digital ID. They see the benefits of it. So that's continuing to kind of be this breakdown of where society falls. I think you have half the people think that it's a good thing and half the people think it's a very scary interference with individual liberty. But then I just go back to Gates again, trying to understand his motivation. Okay, so I put him on the side where he trusts government. He thinks government usually does mostly good. I totally disagree with that, but that's perhaps what Gates thinks, that governments are mostly good, and that having this digital ID is going to be good for public health and good for the people. So you and I may disagree with him from a philosophical perspective and a role of government perspective, but it doesn't make him a sinister bad guy.
I guess it, we'll have to see how it rolls out, and we'll see how things are being coordinated to move us towards that and what the premises are for that, and holding back the letting off the lockdowns. Oh, we have to wait a little longer. While, interestingly, antibody testing is being ramped up, and while, as you said, are we seeing economic models and other evidence or discussion, open discussion about what's the other health consequences of all this, and that's just not happening. So that's very interesting. I tend to come from the left. But I just try to see what's best for society. And it's not about whether government is best, but what's objectively best for society. And this sure doesn't look like it doesn't pass none of this lockdowns, the idea of herding to people towards, you know, antivirals and mass testing and vaccines sure doesn't look like what's best for people on a population level or an individual level.